In the previous lecture, we have seen this example for evaluating synthesized attributes through top-down parsing. Here we have seen that each semantic action is treated as leaf node, and during the traversal of the tree, depth-first traversal of the tree, the semantic action is evaluated. What if a bottom-up parser is to be used for the same? A bottom-up parser is convenient to work with S-attributed definition and synthesized attributes. But now, if inherited attributes are to be evaluated through bottom-up parsing, how it can be done? The problem here is to deal with inherited attributes. How to deal with inherited attributes in case of bottom-up parser is not known. So the idea here is to convert all L-attributed definitions which have inherited attributes to have only synthesized attributes. So consider the following rule. In case of synthesized attributes, the value of the attributes are always computed at the right hand side. So how can the attributes equation be transferred to the end? For this, a new non-terminal is to be added in place of the embedded rules. Thus, if all the rules are at the end of RHS, a bottom-up parser can be used as all the rules look like synthesized attributes. Right? So as shown in equation 2, in this equation. Right? Now consider evaluation of a string by both the rules as shown. In both the cases, same string is derived if we read the leaf nodes star t semantic action 1 e dash semantic action 2. Similarly, star t epsilon semantic action 1 e dash and semantic action 2. Thus, doing this transformation does not affect the language represented by the grammar. Right? This is one way to convert L-attributed definitions with inherited attributes to have synthesized attributes type of look. Now, bottom-up evaluation of inherited attributes. So, considering the translation scheme with embedded semantic action, we make transformation so that all the semantic action appears at the right hand side of the production rules. For this, each embedded semantic action, we introduce a new non-terminal called as marker like M1, M, N, etc. with epsilon productions. Then we attach the semantic action at the end of production related to the new non-terminal or marker, that is M derives to epsilon. Consider the following translation scheme for converting infix expression to postfix expression. We have already seen this. So now the above translation scheme is transferred as shown below. So in place of the embedded semantic action in the rule, marker M and N are placed, right? So these are just simple syntactic transformation such that it introduces some redundancy in the grammar with L attributed definitions and places all the attribute definition at the new place that is created corresponding to the new non-terminals, right? So due to this, space on the stack for storing inherited attribute is created, right? So thus a bottom-up parser can be created for this particular grammar as all the rules looks like synthesized attributes. So how this inherited attributes are used on parser stacks, right? How they are used on parser stacks. So suppose when a bottom-up parser with synthesized attribute is used, and consider a production rule as derives to AB, and suppose AB is to be reduced to S. So first of all, we pop AB from the stack and then push S onto the stack. And at that point, we know that the synthesized attributes of A and B are already present on the value stack, right? So value stack of synthesized attribute of S is computed before the reduction is done, and then we push it onto the value stack, right? So now if we are restricting the productions to have only L attributed definition, then the value of inherited attribute of B in this production depends only on the inherited attributes of S or on synthesized or inherited attributes of A, right? So generally this inherited attribute of B are copy of synthesized attributes of A. Why? So if we consider S as a root node over here, then S inherited is undefined, right? Because we don't have parent of S, so it is not inherited, so it is undefined, right? Thus the value of A being L attributed definition depends only on inherited attribute of S. So if inherited attribute of S is not defined, then inherited attribute of A will also be not defined. Thus inherited attribute of B only depends on the synthesized attributes of A if A have some rules like A derives to XY or so, right? So hence the inherited attribute of B is nothing but a copy of synthesized attribute of A, right? So here the value of synthesized attribute of A can be inherited by B simply by using copy rule. So now consider the following grammar with L attributed definitions. For example, int x, y and z, this is a declaration, and for this we have already seen the grammar, but here I have embedded the action at the right place, right? So d derives to t, then there is semantic action L inherited is equals to t type followed by L. T derives to int and we have a semantic action t dot type equals to integer. T derives to real, we have t type equals to real. L derives to L1 inherited equals to L inherited L1 comma id, and then a semantic action add type id dot entry dot L inherited, right? And then L derives to id and add type id dot entry comma L inherited, right? So let us try to parse the given string, that is int xyz, through a bottom up parser. So now it will use, obviously it will make use of stack, right? And the first thing it will have int on the value stack, right, and t on the state stack after int is reduced to t, right? And id will be on the top of the value stack, right? We'll have x, right? Value stack will have x when state stack will have id, right? So this id is a handle, so it will be reduced to L, right? And it will, when this id is reduced to L by the rule L derives to id, correct, it will make an entry in the symbol table about what? About type of x, right? So you know that the value of type of x is just below this L over here, the L, and this is just below it. We'll get the value of this as int in the value stack. Similarly, later on what will happen, comma will be pushed and id will be pushed on the state stack, and corresponding to id, y will be pushed in the value stack, right? Okay, then when L comma id is matched as a handle, then what will happen? It will be reduced to again L, right? So when it will be reduced to L, its value will be computed, and again we'll have y, and again consecutively we'll have z on the stack, and then the value of its type will be present there. So here you can see that in this particular case, when L comma id is reduced to L, we'll have the semantic action executed over here, and this int value will be present at top minus 3. So before reduction, this will be evaluated type. So this will be present at top minus 3. So here it can be observed that whenever a string is reduced to L, its value is just present below it on the stack, like just below L, right? So now if we go on parsing this string, this will be the actions that will be taken place. And here it is observed that whenever a string is reduced to L, t val is just below it on the stack. We have seen in the previous slide. That means the location of t val on the stack is already known, right? And whenever L derives to ID is used for reduction, then ID.entry is at the top of the stack and T.type is just below it. Hence, we know add type ID.entry, L inherited is nothing but add type value of top, value of top minus 1. We have seen that at the value of top, it was the variable and value of top minus 1 was consisting of the type. So we'll make this entry in the symbol table. Similarly, when L, ID is reduced to L, right? The ID.entry is on the top of the stack and T.type is but nothing but at top minus 3. We have seen this, right? So similarly, add.type id dot entry L inherited will be nothing but add type value on the top value on top minus 3. Correct? Okay. So this unique thing here is whenever a reduction takes place, there is a predetermined place on the stack where the values of these attributes will be stored. Right. So now this scheme works only if the grammar is defined in a way that it allows the position of the attributes to be predicted. In other case, this method will not be feasible. Right. So after this, the grammar will be like this, or the semantic action or the translation scheme will be like this. D derives to TL, T derives to int, then val of top will be equals to integer. T derives to real, val of top is equals to real. L derives to L1, ID. Then we'll have a semantic action that is add type val of top, val of top minus 3. L derives to ID, add type val top, val of top minus 1. Okay. Now simulating the evaluation of inherited attributes, how this will be simulated, right? So consider this particular grammar. Like in the previous slide, we have seen that there was a problem. What was that problem? That is, if the location is not predictable, right? If it is not predictable, then there was a problem. So like in this case, like if we have a grammar S derives to AAC and the inherited attribute of C is equals to synthesized attribute of A, and in the second rule, S derives to B, A, B, C, inherited attribute of C here depends on synthesized attribute of A. C derives to X and synthesized attribute of C is nothing but some function of inherited attributes of C, right? So here it is not fixed whether the deduction will be done by rule 1 or rule 2, that is by S derives to A, A, C or S derives to B, A, B, C, right? Thus, in this case, the position of synthesized attribute of A is not fixed, or we cannot predict, because if it uses rule 1, then it can be at top minus 1. But if it uses rule number 2, then the value of synthesized attribute of A can be at top minus 2. Right. So to solve this problem, what we do, we introduce a new non-terminal, right, in the grammar, right? Like suppose here, see the same example. If we use this particular rule, A synthesized is present at top minus 1, but if we use this rule, the A synthesized is present at top minus 2. So this is confusing where this is reduction. So whenever C X will be reduced to C, we won't have the value of inherited attributes of C at that point, because it depends on synthesized attribute of A and we don't know the location of synthesized attribute of A, whether it is at top minus 1 or top minus 2. So to avoid this problem, what we do, we add a new non-terminal and write the new grammar as like this. S derives to AAC, S derives to BABMC, C derives to X and M derives to epsilon, right? So in this case, what happens? The stack entry, state stack entry will be like this, that is A, A, B, then M will be placed in between and later on C. So whenever this X is reduced to C, at that time we need the value of A synthesized below the C, below C, right, at top minus 1. So what we can do, we can simply copy the value of A synthesized in the value of m inherited, right? So if we do so, then we'll always get the value of a synthesized below c whenever x is reduced to c, and this is what we wanted. That is, every time we should have a fixed value for a synthesized. So what we can do, we can simply copy a synthesized into m inherited, right? Correct. So if a synthesized is copied to m inherited, then it doesn't matter which rule is used for reduction, right? And value of a synthesized will always be below c whenever x is reduced to c, correct? So now when m derives to epsilon is used, then m synthesized will be nothing but m inherited, right? And m inherited is nothing but a synthesized, so automatically we'll get a synthesized. Okay, hence value of c inherited is always available at where, obviously, top minus 1, right? But this is the case. Okay, but what if the rules are not just copy rules, right? If it is some function of some other attributes, right? Other than copy rule, it can be some function also, right? So at that time also we can make use of markers, right? So markers can also be used to simulate if the rules are not just a copy rules. Okay, so now these were simple examples that we considered, but now for doing this we need a generalized method. So here I present a generalized algorithm for translation of inherited attributes through bottom-up parser, and here we'll consider only that the grammar will have L attributed definitions. Okay, so now suppose there is a production in the grammar rule, that is S derives to a1 a2 ... an, right? And now here we'll assume that all the non-terminals have inherited attributes and all other symbols have synthesized attributes. So what we'll do here, we'll just make use of markers and we'll insert n number of markers for all the symbols of the grammar. Like the production here will become S derives to m1 a1 m2 a2 ... an, and we'll add m1 derives to epsilon, m2 derives to epsilon, and ... mn derives to epsilon to the production rule, right? So here the synthesized attributes of aj will goes onto the value stack of aj, right? As we have seen always that in case of bottom up parser, that is synthesized attribute of any variable or non-terminal is beside it on the value stack, right? Similarly here, but now we have created additional space. This will be many spaces because there will be markers for everything. Some of them may be empty, right? So these markers will be used for storing what? Inherited attributes, right? So inherited attributes of aj goes into the value entry of marker for mj, right? So this new location will be used for storing inherited attributes of the non-terminals or the variables, right? So whenever there is a reduction for mj, like if there is a reduction mj derives to epsilon, that is epsilon is reduced to mj, and suppose it belongs to a production like S derives to what we have considered m1 a1 m2 a2 ... mn an, in this case if mj belongs to this particular thing, then what we'll have, we'll have inherited attributes of S. This is shown in this particular figure also, that inherited attribute of S will be present at top minus 2j. This is top minus 2j, and then from here 2 plus. So here we'll have, that is top minus 2j plus 2, will get the inherited attribute of m1, right? Or mj. Clear? Is it okay? And then inherited attributes of a1 will be present. So where is inherited attribute of a1? So inherited attribute of a1 will be obviously beside m1, right? So this m1 is present where? It is present at top minus 2j plus 3, 1, 2 and 3, that is top minus 4. So this will be present at top minus 2j plus 1, 2 and 3. So this is the location. Similarly, where will be the synthesized attributes of a1? So the synthesized attribute of a1 will be beside it, that is at top minus 2j plus 1, 2, 3 and 4, Right. So in this way, you can get the locations where this inherited attribute of or synthesized attribute of any variable is present. Right. So now, if s derives to m1, m a1, m2, a2, dot dot dot, mn, an is reduced, then we compute the synthesized attributes of s and we push it onto the stack. Right. Is that okay? Okay. So this is how you can implement what we say inherited attributes for a bottom-up parser. Okay, thank you.